Chair Anderson, you can go ahead and start. We are live.
All right, thank you, thank you. I'd like to call this meeting of the Mission Fulfillment Committee of the University of Minnesota Board of Regents to order. Good morning, everyone, and thank you to those who are joining us via the live stream video and those attending in person with us here on the Twin Cities campus. One, two, three, four, five, six. We've got six of us here, so we're not lonely. We're meeting again in this hybrid format, and I think we are all comfortable with the meeting protocol. So just a quick reminder that if you'd like to speak, please use the raise hand feature in Zoom or alert Ms. Flotman. Before we turn to our agenda, I'd like to just say welcome to our student representatives, Student Representative Purdue Swanson and Student Representative Demuth. Thank you for being with us this morning. It looks like we have a short agenda, but really it's kind of full, and we're gonna get through it. There's only two really big items on the agenda, but they are going to be discussed in detail. The first one is going to be academic and research planning work group update, which they've been working on for quite a while and are going to update, as it says. And then secondly, we're going to have a system-wide enrollment management plan discussion, which includes every campus and representatives from every campus telling us how they're doing. So as we get going, our first item today is an update from the Academic and Research Planning Work Group. Provost Croson and Vice President Kramer will be leading that discussion. But before I turn it over to them, President Gable, would you like to provide some introductory comments?
Yes, thank you, Chair Anderson, Vice Chair Davenport, and members of the committee. We do have a full but important Mission Fulfillment Committee agenda for you today. And the first thing that Provost Croson and Vice President Kramer will be leading you through is an update and outcomes from the Academic and Research Planning Work Group. This group was charged on April 10th, at the beginning of our response to the pandemic, to advise the board and me on strategies to advance the university and its core mission in the midst of the challenges posed by COVID-19. The work group was guided by a distinct set of principles, which you approved at a special board meeting on April 21st. This work has been led by our provost and by Vice President for Research, Chris Kramer, to examine four guiding questions that range from how we curate our mission and ensure that the core attributes of our work endure despite the challenges posed by the pandemic, to how we remain a university of choice for both current and future students, amongst other issues that they explored. I want to take a moment to express my thanks to Rachel and Chris for their leadership and to the entire membership of the committee. And I would also like to express my appreciation for the broad engagement and consultation from our university community with work group members, including through robust online surveys. Rachel and Chris are here to talk about the recommendations, which were significantly informed by the strategic plan MPAC 2025. And the many conversations held and feedback that they received through a variety of consultation points. So at this time, with appreciation, I'll turn it over to Rachel and Chris to frame the findings in greater detail. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay, and thank you, President Gable. So I think with no further ado, I'm just gonna turn it over to Provost Croson and listen to the presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, President Gable, Chair Anderson, members of the board. You can go ahead to the next slide. Vice President Kramer and I, and the members of the work group, began our work with the President's charge and the principles approved by the Board of Regents shown on this slide. We returned to these two documents repeatedly throughout our process. Vice President Kramer and I will tag team during this presentation, and I know either of us would be happy to answer any questions you might have. You can go ahead to the next slide. A key responsibility of the work group was to guide the university in responding to the high likelihood of declining resources. We approached this work acutely aware of the ambiguity and anxiety stemming from the pandemic, and also with the recognition that many of our units have already faced significant budget pressure. Throughout our work, the work group discussed how change can be difficult, yet is ultimately necessary to ensure the health and stability of the university. Furthermore, we explicitly discussed how there's often opportunity in crisis and how we might guide the university to utilize this crisis as a catalyst for innovation. The work group's purpose with this report is not to determine which specific programs to accelerate or discontinue, but rather to provide guidance and criteria for budgetary authorities as they consider their path forward. These recommendations were drawn heavily from the Impact 2025 System-Wide Strategic Plan to ensure that the plan would be implemented and advanced during this challenging time. The report also highlights the critical importance of advancing diversity, equity, inclusion, and social and racial justice, especially in the midst of financial challenges. As difficult decisions are made, we must not only continue, but elevate our efforts toward creating diverse, welcoming, and just campus communities, and recognize and support our Black faculty and staff, Indigenous faculty and staff, and faculty and staff of color who demonstrate a long-term commitment to this work. Vice President Kramer.
Good morning, members of the board, President Gable, and my colleague and co-chair, Provost Croson. If we could go to the next slide. So a work group with a charge this broad in scope is in some sense difficult to adequately populate and yet at the same time be sufficiently nimble to in fact make progress. So we always in the academy seek a best compromise between those. So the work group in this case did include chancellors from campuses other than the Twin Cities. It included student representatives, faculty representatives, governance representatives, staff representatives, and obviously Provost Croson and myself as co-chairs. And the need to encompass the huge breadth of our university system is really why consultation is so important. And frankly, it serves two roles in some sense. One obviously is to harvest the thoughts and ideas from the broadest possible set of constituencies. But in addition, the actual act of consultation, in this case, again and again and again, we consulted this really thoroughly. It is frankly that it disseminates the message to the community of how important this is. I think we're all familiar with the huge bombardment of email that arrives daily, and a lot of people have a tendency to just hit delete buttons sometimes, especially when it comes from the administration, sad though that be. But by engaging in these thoughtful consultations, hopefully we have impressed upon the community the importance of assessing how are we going to move forward, the degree to which this is a long-term process. It's meant to guide us for the next several years. And so you see here the list of places we did consult. And so that includes governance committees, which are formed of faculty, staff, and students across leaderships of departments and campuses around the system in various venues. And as President Gable mentioned, with an online survey distributed to the entirety of the student, faculty, and staff population. And then finally, certain specific interested groups, that was mostly in my area for the research mission. For instance, the Council of Research Associate Deans is a terrifically important consultative body for me, and also animal users in research, researchers who work with human subjects. These were all consulted as well to understand impacts for our research mission. If you would move to the next slide, please. And so here you see the charge that the president delivered to us at the outset of our efforts. How would we curate our mission and ensure that we endure through the challenges of the COVID-19 pandemic? But I do want to come back to the point that we took our charge really to be looking forward for more than just an immediate response to an immediate crisis. Instead, it was how will we come out of this crisis better prepared to continue to endure for a future that has uncertainties associated with it, obviously. What steps should we take to remain a university of choice for our current and future students? That's obviously always on our mind and always appropriate to discuss. What are the criteria, as Provost Croson emphasized, that will be used as unit leaders are thinking about how will they shrink, grow, prioritize, sell their programs to those with budget authority in terms of their importance and their centrality. And finally, of course, here's the one that has the word research in it, which is why I'm so excited. How do we double down on our research distinction and in particular take advantage of the intersections that developed out of the strategic plan? So these recommendations, as noted, we'll say more probably about alignment with strategic plan, but some of the metrics that we would anticipate using to assess progress in implementing some of the strategies here will include the metrics that are under discussion by the board. Obviously, some of those have been in the maroon and gold measures of the existing university progress card, and there are ongoing discussions of which of those remain important, what new ones should we be adding. We're looking forward to interfacing with those discussions. Give it back to you, Rachel.
Okay, Provost Carlson.
Go ahead to the next slide, please. So we're going to walk through each of these four charges and describe a little bit about what's in the report. Of course, the report itself is in your docket, and we're happy to take questions about it. So in addressing the first question in our charge, we focused on the key question about how we should do this. And so in this section of the report, we describe the process that we should use to determine how to proceed. We emerged with four recommendations for this process. Our process and our implementation needs to be nimble. It needs to be inclusive. It needs to be effective. And it needs to be creative. So what we mean by each of these adjectives is described here in the slide and in the report. And the report also includes some suggestions that we might think about how to implement these processes and these methods. You can go ahead to the next slide. So our second guiding question focused on actions we can take to remain a university of choice for our students. Again, the report contains specifics, but here I'll share with you a few examples. Concerning pricing, we recommend increasing need-based EED, developing strategic tuition plans, increasing strategic partnerships and sponsors, and investing in system-wide undergraduate recruitment strategies. Concerning content, we recommend developing joint degrees, building more flexible curriculum and scheduling, expanding student research and co-curricular experiences, continuing commitment to international work, and developing new programs for non-traditional students. Concerning modality, we recommend developing system-wide learning models, leveraging university expertise in teaching, exploring course partnerships, addressing classroom climates, all with the goal of attracting new and diverse students. Vice President Kramer.
So if I could have the next slide, please. Charge three, what criteria do you recommend for pausing, ending, accelerating, or launching new programs, academic or other, during the pandemic and beyond? And of course, this is a terrifically important question and informs budgeting at the most minute level of detail. Certainly top criterion is alignment with the system-wide strategic plan. The whole point, obviously, of doing a strategic plan is to provide one a framework in which to make these kinds of decisions. And to some extent, we regarded our work as being a group that would have been formed in any case, even in the absence of a pandemic crisis, in order to begin the process of thinking how to use the strategic plan effectively to make plans for the future. At the same time, as was sort of noted, given our start point, we couldn't ignore the events that were happening in the Twin Cities, in the United States, around the world to some extent, throughout the summer. And we heard from very passionate voices throughout our community how critical it was that we, as a research institution and a land-grant university, be paying attention to issues of equity and justice, educational equity, educating about justice, and ensuring, number five there, the successful and equitable outcomes of our students. So we need to be a beacon on that front and set standards that others will look to as exemplary. Important criterion number four, the evidence of using high impact practices. So there is a, particularly in the area, I would say, of sort of teaching and pedagogy, there is a scholarship of teaching and pedagogy. We know from research what works best in programs. How do you achieve the learning outcomes that are desired? And we want to be certain that we're investing in programs that are using those best practices, demonstrating the use of those best practices. These are often, and we check that regularly by having program reviews where outside experts come in and deliver to us their assessment of how well are we performing against what are regarded as best practices for that field from that community. Talent needs, it's important for us to recognize our role in service to the state and the degree to which we are training a future, I hate to use the word workforce in higher education, but we're training future talented individuals who will contribute to our state's economic success and the nation's economic success. Financial sustainability, in the end, we do have to balance the budgets of individual programs, and it's critical to keep an eye on the degree to which demand may be influencing a need for a program, the degree to which it is critical for other programs, how can we ensure that the resources flow appropriately. Signature strengths is an important criterion. You know, there are certain payoffs you get reputationally from areas where you're simply recognized internationally, nationally, as a leader in a field. And it's a magnet that draws talent and keeps you in the public eye, and that can be to the good when it's for favorable reasons, obviously. And then finally, engagement and outreach. It's critical to our mission that our citizens in the state of Minnesota and the various stakeholders that we serve recognize our contributions to them, are engaged so we understand what their desires are in terms of those contributions. And we always want, as the land grant, to be making those connections and ensuring that we are responding in a timely fashion to them. If I could have the next slide, please. And then the final charge, how do we double down on our research distinction with an emphasis on interceptions? And so, you know, talent. It's a little like real estate's location. In terms of research distinction, it's talent. So we need to recruit and retain excellent faculty, dare I say, field-shaping faculty. I don't know, did anybody notice we got two geniuses awarded yesterday? So the MacArthur Foundation recognizing Professors Dauenhauer and Fair, just, you know, an indication of how hard we work to attract and support that kind of talent. And that's a tremendous testament to the outstanding work that those two do, and no other university in the nation managed to. So I'm just going to glow with that for a little while. But when you have that kind, I'll come back to, when you get those kind of reputational splashes, that's what attracts the other outstanding talent. So graduate students, potential prospective graduate students, notice that. They come to the University of Minnesota to work with these people who have these high profiles. Staff engage in that. Funding agencies notice that. So we can't ignore that. We've got to invest and attract those individuals. And in order to do that, the second bullet, you really have to provide them the infrastructure, core facilities when we're talking about kinds of research, support needed to pursue their scholarship. So Dr. Fair, in particular, I think I'll call out, relatively recently recruited to the University of Minnesota because of the amazing infrastructure we could offer for his program. That includes massive magnets to do functional magnetic resonance imaging, massive computing resources to do the image analysis that's necessary, the Masonic Institute for the Developing Brain, which was a bold commitment to a collaboration between the Institute for Child Development, the medical school, our College of Education and Human Development. It's those sorts of construction, exciting and thoughtful opportunities that lead to success. And then finally, the last bullet, and one that excites me particularly, is the intersections aspect of the strategic plan. So by articulating broad areas, the intersections research areas are not meant to be the exclusive focus of the university's research mission, but they do serve as sort of a North Star rally point around which we can make decisions, we can make strategic investments, and moreover, we can message the degree to which, as President Gable says, we tackle problems that are inspired locally, important locally, but have global impact. And as you know, those are in the broad areas of health and sustainability and natural resource and agro-food systems. And I don't want to sell Professor Dauenhauer short as long as we're celebrating MacArthur's. His work in the area of sustainability is a great example of something that intersections will be able to highlight, build around, and contribute to further success. So that is our last, if you want to go to the splash slide with the logo, that is the end of our overview, and we are very much looking forward to questions and discussion on this report. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Vice President Kramer and Provost Croson. You're done with your discussion.
Please go ahead.
Let's turn to our discussion. If you have a question or comment, please use the raise hand feature or alert Ms. Flotten. Ms. Flotten, do we have anyone at this time who would like to speak?
Mr. Chair, I don't see any raised hands yet.
Okay. Regent Sviggum.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. If we could go back to the slide that talks about the criteria for the program decision making, please.
Do we know what number that is, or do we know what it is?
I don't know what number it is, I guess.
Probably slide 8.
Let's see, slide 8. That would be great. Chris is always right.
Yep.
I have a question just in regards to my feeling, my thought concept of number 5 on that slide, Chris, when we talk about the successful, equitable student outcomes. Can you go into how you will make sure that that takes place, what the process is? I've always thought that in government, we need to provide peoples, all folks, an equality of opportunity. But we cannot provide, nor should we provide, an equality of result. And this almost looks like we're trying to guarantee an equality result, and I don't know how that is accomplished through that.
Vice President Kramer, do you have an answer to that question?
Sure, I'm happy to address it, and then I think Provost Croson probably should weigh in as well, because students are very provostal. Regent Sviggum, I think you make an excellent point, and I think that the issue of ensuring that there are equal opportunities is quite critical. And in fact, I think when we talk about successful and equitable outcomes, what we largely mean is we're going to be responsive to the potentially differential needs of different student populations as they arrive in order to ensure that our programs are, and I believe I've heard the president use this language, meeting them where they are. And so given the diversity of students that we bring in as freshmen and the diversity of backgrounds they may come from, whether that be very small rural high schools, large urban environments, international students, we want to be sure that the programs are equipped in order to foster success in all of them upon their arrival and ultimately deliver a graduating cohort that's had the opportunity to excel. It's an important given that there are responsibilities on the students' part as well to engage with their programs and be successful, but we want to be sure that they have the best foundation from which to do that and be providing the tools that they can be successful. So I think I'd ask my colleague Provost Croson to add to that.
Provost Croson.
Sure. So I fully agree with Chris's comments and responses. I just want to remind everybody that these are criteria that we're using to think about programs. And so as we evaluate a program, if we see a program that is not generating successful and equitable outcomes, then it would be a question of what's going on in this program? Why are the expectations inappropriate? Are they differential with respect to different people or different types? Is there some other barrier that's inhibiting that success? And so as Chris mentioned, this is one of course many criteria that we're using, but as we're thinking about entering into tight budget times and deciding what to prioritize, programs that are successful in this, that generate success, high levels of successful and equitable outcomes are ones that we would want to prioritize.
All right, thank you. Regent Sviggum, does that answer the questions?
Not really. I think we're talking about opportunities rather than results. And I don't think that we need to, I'm above my pay grade. I'm above what I need to, It just seems to me to change a program to get the results that are, quote, equitable isn't necessarily the right direction.
I would agree with you that we're about opportunity, and then it's what we can provide that leads those outcomes. And the student, the university, and everything will each get to their own outcomes, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Regent Beeson.
Thank you. Mr. Chair, I did not have a question or comment.
Okay, somebody gave me your name, but I, that's okay. Regent Rocha, do you have a question or comment? Or are we just pulling them out of the air?
I have my little blue hand up. thank you, Mr. Chair. So I've got, I guess, a couple questions. I'll throw one out and see how long it takes. If it takes a long time, I'll hold the other one. But my first question is, if we go to slide 7, you know, there's a lot of good weighty stuff to talk about here, and I think some significant stuff as we go to develop this plan. It talks here on slide 7 about you know, as far as content to pursue, that you talk about programs for non-traditional students. This is, you know, I'm interested in what that, you know, what kinds of programs we're talking about with respect to non-traditional students. Maybe I'll ask if you can kind of elucidate that a little bit, and then maybe I'll have a comment.
Provost Colson, do you want to try that question?
Sure. So, of course, when we talk about non-traditional students, there are different categories, and this report was not particularly specific about exactly which ones we should undertake, but they are. It was specific about exploring what's out there. So, of course, one is a non-traditional student who is seeking an undergraduate degree. So somebody who's been in the workforce for a while, who's maybe returning to school, who's had some other disruptions in their lives and is now trying to sort of get back to the university. And we already, of course, have many paths for that population, but exploring more about what that population might need would be one direction that this could go. I think a second is to think about non-degree seeking students who need to learn some skill, who are interested in advancing in their careers, who are looking for more certificates, more, you know, possibly for credit bearing, possibly non-credit bearing. Again, we already do quite a bit of this, especially through CCAPS and some of our other arms, but it's a market that I think we need to make sure we're attentive to.
Mr. Chair?
Go ahead, sir.
Thank you. And that's and kind of what I was sensing. And here's, I just want to put a caveat, if not a caution on this. You know, with technology, things have changed, and I think we have the capacity to try to reach some of these constituencies or needs. But if we, you know, a bit of a history lesson, you know, when the university, when we were sitting at a 14% graduation rate after, 5 years, 30 years ago, part of the challenge was that the university had, as some people would describe it, been trying to be all things to all people. And that ultimately, because at one point when the university was essentially the only show in town, we could afford to do that. We received all the state support and so on. But as we saw the state university system, Metro State come online and community colleges and technical schools online, there were other ways of providing that type of training or education and to people. And we really embarked on a strong focus on what would, you know, be called traditional student, or at least, you know, sort of the first time undergraduate student experience, some people coming back perhaps after some career or military service and so on. And so I just would say that if it's something that we can leverage with technology and provide access to people who have unusual schedules because maybe they have families and, you know, and or careers at the same time, that makes sense. But I would be very cautious about re-embarking on a process of creating another layer of offerings that would diminish what we're offering to our undergraduate student population in that particular way. Just because having seen us try to do that and having seen the very significant effects that it had. And part of the problem back then was it was a headcount thing. Anybody that took an extension class was considered a student. That impacted our overall graduation rates. And so we work very, very well with the other systems, with the 2-year and 4-year universities across the state. And some of those, particularly because of the geographic access that they provide, being as far flung as they are, really provides great opportunities for non-traditional students. So if we're going to go down that road in any significant way, one, I'd say technology has got to be a key part of it, as opposed to creating a whole new set of classes in the evenings sort of thing. And we should also probably stay in very close contact with the Minnesota State Colleges and Universities to make sure we're not duplicating what they can provide, perhaps in better form, and then, you know, but still looking to capitalize on what we provide. That's my comment on that, Mr. Chair. I'll hold my other question unless there's more time later. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Regent Rocha. I appreciate it.
Mr. Chair, could I add to that discussion?
Go ahead, Vice President Kramer.
So, Mr. Rocha, I strongly agree with you that the University of Minnesota occupies a region on the higher educational spectrum, and we do best when we are strong in our region, and we shouldn't try to cover the entire spectrum. And you brought up a point that I think is important, but also indicates where there are special opportunities, and Provost Croson alluded to that as well. And that's really in the kind of certificate credentialing, which has become so much more important in the last 10 or 20 years, I would say. And a particularly good example, because it's always good to call out specifics, would be in data science. So data science is a relatively recent program at the graduate level that the board approved within just the last 5, 6, 7 years, I want to say. And that program developed as a graduate program, so certainly in our space, it was sort of quickly realized that for those non-traditional students who didn't want to pursue the full master's or PhD degree, but wanted certificate credentialing, it didn't require the construction of new courses. Really, they could participate in existing pedagogy. And so we were expanding enrollment and using technology, because certainly in data science, everybody's pretty good at being online. And that is a revenue opportunity without necessarily an additional upfront investment cost. So I think paying attention to those sorts of areas where we're in that sweet spot between a full graduate degree and a baccalaureate degree is a place where the university can be very successful.
Thank you, Vice President Kramer. We're going to go to Regent Powell.
Thank you, Chair Anderson, and thank you, Rachel and Chris, for the presentation and the good work of this committee. I mean, I really appreciate that you're trying to get ahead, on this in the middle of a crisis situation. And, you know, this work's been very collaborative, and I appreciate it. So here's sort of a comment and then a question. It strikes me that much of the work that you've done, you know, here, and it needs to be this way, has been, you know, fairly, it's narrowly focused, narrow and deep in a way, department by department. And I think that is super important. And we have to, you know, because we really do have to help our students in their, you know, kind of fields of choice, go deep. But I don't know, I guess old fashioned guy. I mean, I do think we have, as we think about academic planning, particularly for undergraduates, there is a broadening sort of responsibility that we have, I think. And, you know, we really need to make sure that our students come out and they've been exposed in really meaningful ways to humanities and social sciences and other disciplines. And that's an important part of value. And it's curious to me, and a little bit concerning, that we sort of haven't really talked about how this all fits together in, you know, what is it, you know, what does it mean to us? You know, what do we think it should mean, you know, in 2020 to be educated? And this is really primarily, to me, is very focused on discipline by discipline. But there is this broader thing, I think, that we're trying to do. And so anyway, that, I guess, is a comment, but also a question. I'd like to hear your thoughts on that. So thank you.
Thank you, Regent Powell. Provost Croson, did you want to try that? Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Chair Anderson, Regent Powell. So I fully agree as a social scientist myself that part of what one needs in order to be an educated citizen and informed citizen is a broad scope in one's education. My understanding is just before I arrived, the university undertook an attempt to revise the liberal education curriculum. And that paused for all kinds of reasons, and then COVID hit. But that is absolutely something that I intend to take up in the next year or two, is to sort of revitalize that effort to think about what it is that we're teaching our students in order to generate informed and responsible citizens for the next generation.
Regent Powell, does that get to the crux of your question? Your comments?
Yeah, well, it does. And I'm really happy to hear that, Provost Croson is going to take take another swing, at revitalizing, the broader liberal education curriculum. And, anyway, I think, and I guess there are other regions who would agree. I think that's really, really important. And I hope we can get to that, sooner rather than later. Thanks.
Thank you. Regent Davenport.
Thank you, Chair Anderson and Provost Croson and Vice VP Kramer. Thank you and your work team for the great work. First, I want to add an emphasis to Regent Rocha's comments and VP Kramer's response. There is a sweet spot and many opportunities for innovation and program offerings, which I think do reflect or promise solid investments going into the future. And second, Provost Croson, what are the next steps in terms of relaying expectations to division leaders and others around the reviews and addressing the criteria? Is there a timeline as we look at implementation? Thank you.
Provost Croson.
Yes, thank you, Regent Davenport, Chair Anderson. So indeed, the plan is to implement these recommendations through the compact process, through the budgeting process within the university. And so each head of an RRC, each head of a unit with budgetary authority, meets with the Budget 5 to discuss their planning for the next fiscal year. And as part of that planning, it's routine to think about what types of programs are going to be prioritized and what kinds of programs are going to be discontinued or weaned off. That leads to many of the actions that you see in front of you on consent agendas. And so part of the plan is to ensure that these criteria are part of that budgetary process and part of the budgetary planning and are used in order to approve or guide people who are making those budgetary decisions into how we're going to move forward.
Thank you. Regent Davenport, does that cover your questions or comments?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Regent Beeson, we're going to try this again?
We're going to try it a second time. I do have some comments. Thanks to the dialogue that has just preceded me. I do respect Regent Davenport's direct career experience in this area, and so I listened to her words carefully. And the prompt that Regent Rocha made, sort of where does mission creep, versus responding to an emerging market of non-traditional students, where does that all shake out? I resonated with Vice President Kramer's comment about the need to really look at this carefully from a financial standpoint, that these new offerings, whatever they are, and by the way, I think in general, Minnesota State's probably a little better suited to the certificate and the credential sort of world, but there are areas where we can leverage our existing faculty and programs and expertise, and it may be heavily on the graduate side where it is appropriate to do it. But I think really looking at that, as the Vice President said, with sort of what is the investment cost against the expected enrollment, and because we can't afford these to be lost leaders, unless it's so mission critical, unless it's so important that we're willing to write that subsidy. But I'm glad we'll look at it from a financial point of view. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Chair. Regent Beeson, I guess Provost Croson, did you want to take a stab at that? Or
I think Regent Beeson, Chair Anderson, I think you're exactly right that we don't want to be starting things up that are not mission critical and not revenue generating.
I would agree with that. Regent Rocha, did we want to have a second chance?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. And just as we, I think, came through this pretty quickly, my second question, and it builds a bit off of Regent Powell's conversation, and I would associate with his comments and the value of the type of education one receives at an institution like the university is such, the broadening experience, I think, is such a critical part of the value of a baccalaureate degree. On slide 8, kind of following down that road, I found number 3 interesting, and if somebody could explain that a little bit, and that's the education around justice. Could somebody kind of explain a little bit more what that concept is.
Is that the correct slide? I mean,
it's number, is, okay. Slide number eight, number three, it says education around justice.
Okay, number I look at number eight.
Curious kind of how that works. What that looks like.
Sure. So again, these are criteria that we're using to help budgetary authorities think about what they should prioritize and what they should end. And we felt that programs that provided our students with an understanding about social justice, racial justice, about the crises that the nation and to some extent the world are going through are particularly important to make sure that they continue.
Mr. Sheriff,
go ahead, Regent Rocha.
Thank you. And it may be part of it is sort of, you know, having come from the College of Agriculture in particular, and in looking at that, I look at that and I think, well, how does a new program in agronomy, you know, meet that standard? And I'm also, you know, a little bit concerned, just, you know, what are the kind of outside of the academy, you know, people I think there are criticisms about, we want to, you know, try to walk that line between ensuring people understand these concepts and are exposed to these concepts and can develop opinions about these concepts, as opposed to are sort of required to have a certain type of perspective. And I'm interested in, you know, how this doesn't end up becoming kind of an interplay that sort of creates the groupthink that people are sort of concerned about, and I think some data shows that there is sort of a consolidation of viewpoints within the academy, and just making sure that we do understand that there are some, you know, pedagogies that, you know, that work on, you know, kind of more sort of objective type concepts, and whereas obviously there are some degrees that are very much about pursuing social justice and the like. So I'm very interested, as we go forward, I'll be very interested to see how that impacts the capacity for us to sort of develop across a wide range of academic subjects to make sure that we're not, again, sort of consolidating into an accepted, you know, way of thinking that prevents us from having the full range of viewpoints that provides that balance and makes well-rounded graduates as we go forward. Thank you.
I think your topics, Regent Rocha, your comments are very, very well taken, and we have to be careful where we tread. I don't know if Provost Croson needs to answer that or not, other than probably agree with that.
I fully agree. We need to be training people who understand and respect diverse viewpoints and can think critically about important social issues.
Thank you for the comments, Regent Rocha. I don't see any more hands up. I'm going to make a quick comment. You know, it's interesting when I read through this in the agenda items and everything. In my 5 years here, when I came, it seemed like we had old institutional ideas to do things. And I just wanted to comment in the guiding questions that your task force has been asked. And I'll also say that this is a work in progress. It keeps going. I saw statements like being nimble, being strategic with tuition plans, looking for alternative revenue sources. I think that there's been, at least in my 5 years here, and I come from a business background, I think there's been a little bit of a shift for the better from old institutional ways of doing things to looking at getting up to the world on how we do things, being nimble, being strategic, being alternative. So I think that's terrific, and that's my two cents on that. I appreciate Vice President Kramer, appreciate the discussion we had, and I, again, as I say, that academic and research planning work group is a work in progress. It will continue on. I'm ready to move to the second agenda item, or if so, and we'll just say that is going to be on system-wide enrollment management. While we queue up all of our presenters, I'm just going to say we'll be devoting a great deal of time to this next item. It's sort of like five items in one. We'll discuss enrollment management across the system and hear from leaders from all five campuses on the topic. I would just ask the presenters, again, I know that the provost's office has asked you to be about 7 or 8 minutes. If you can do that, that's going to take almost 40 minutes of this. And then hopefully we'll have some great questions for all of you.
President Gable, did you want to kick off this presentation?
I do. Thank you, Chair Anderson, Vice Chair Davenport, members of the committee. The university's system-wide enrollment strategy has been a top priority for many years and is documented very overtly in our new MPACT 2025 system-wide strategic plan, in our student success commitment, and very specifically, and you'll hear me discuss this in more detail tomorrow as we refresh our maroon and gold measures and look at how we hold ourselves both to be inspired and accountable. Today, you're going to hear an update on the five-year enrollment plans for each campus, including future considerations and analysis around enrollment changes, student success measures, and the status and use of admissions tests as part of the criteria. This is an interesting moment in time to be having this conversation. We normally look at long game trends based on historical data. We find ourselves disrupted in that process based on the events of the pandemic and other headwinds that are simply coming to the fore or are catalyzed by the impacts of the pandemic. So joining us today to have this discussion are John Hoffman from Crookston, Fernando Delgado from Duluth, Melissa Burt from Morris, Jeffrey Ratliff Crane from Rochester, Bob McMaster from the Twin Cities, and of course our Provost Rachel Croson. So at this time, I will turn it over to them. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Provost Croson, do you want to move on here? I just had to chuckle. It's great that we got Geography Professor McMaster on there, so we got all the campuses, and if he has to, he can point out where they are on the map.
Always good to have a geographer on your staff. Thank you, President Gable, Chair Anderson, members of the committee. Over the past few years, much work has been directed toward cross-campus cooperation and system coordination of undergraduate enrollment management. It's become our tradition to report on those efforts at your June meeting. I imagine you remember that conversation from a few months ago, and we're scheduled to provide that update again in June 2021. In contrast, today's focus is on each individual campus's undergraduate enrollment planning and student success initiatives. Both are important. Each campus's objectives and plans are designed to fit the distinctive market brand of that campus, and the campuses work together as one system to champion each other's successes, leverage resources across the university, and to mitigate competition with each other. As a reminder, some of the system efforts you may remember hearing about include a system-wide enrollment council, which includes the vice chancellors, vice provost, and campus enrollment leaders who meet regularly and coordinate internally, a recent system enrollment market study, a system website and landing page, application sharing, regular meetings of the admissions directors, and significant shared recruitment work. The rest of this conversation is going to focus on each campus's enrollment planning updates, and I'll turn the conversation over to the campuses in a minute. I do want to highlight one new system-wide effort, which is the recruitment marketing campaign. A few weeks ago, Vice President Matt Kramer shared with you a preview of those campaign elements. The recruitment campaign is titled Discover the University of Minnesota for You. It launched on September 30th. It's a digital-only campaign that shows prospective students and their families how they can find their best fit at one of these campuses. Digital elements include videos, podcasts, and a campaign site featuring real students from across our system. The campaign elements and the benefits that we hope will result are, of course, exciting. But perhaps even more exciting is the cross-campus and cross-unit collaboration that produced this work. We're all grateful to Vice President Kramer, Chief Marketing Officer Ann Aronson, and our many other university relations colleagues for their leadership and the contributions toward this campaign, as well as the contributions of each campus's admissions staff and the System Enrollment Council. As I mentioned, we'll revisit the system-wide initiatives in June, but today you've asked us to provide updates about each campus's enrollment plans and progress. This agenda item thus includes five distinct but coordinated campus conversations, We're going to proceed in alphabetical order by campus, beginning with our Crookston campus and Vice Chancellor John Hoffman.
Vice Chancellor Hoffman, if you're ready, go ahead, sir.
Chair Anderson and members of the board, during the 2018 school year, Crookston developed a plan to grow its degree-seeking enrollment to 2,100 students by fall 2023. We have since updated that plan in light of COVID and also following the discontinuation of our football program with a goal of 2,000 students by fall 2023, and we will achieve the 2,100 students by fall 2025. We have situated our plan within the increasing diversity of the Midwest, and our plan is predicated on discovering talent that other campuses miss. Since much of this talent comes from Black, Indigenous, people of color, first generation college students, and students from lower income families, our plan will contribute to the overall diversity of our campus and thus create an opportunity to increase the quality of education provided to every one of our Golden Eagles. Several of the five-year plan priorities are listed here, but I'll address them through the following slides. Next slide, please. As many of the challenges that we face are common to all five campuses, I will simply note here the unique challenge for Crookston is the relative youth of our four-year alumni. While our first graduates are now sending us their children as students, something we're very excited about, most of them are still years away from prime philanthropic years when they will fund scholarships, programs, and facilities that will attract students. Next slide, please. Key accomplishments in terms of our graduation rates have been meeting our four-year target in three of the past 4 years and achieving the system's highest three-year graduation rate in seven of the past 10. When compared to state and national data, the performance of our students who are low income, first gen, and from Greater Minnesota has also been strong. That said, data for our BIPOC students reveal that we have not served them particularly well over the past 10 years. This has significant fiscal impacts, including unrealized tuition revenues of more than $200,000 per year. But more importantly, all of our students suffer in terms of educational quality when BIPOC students are unable to contribute to educational dialogues and problem solving on our campus. Lastly, I'll note that with the discontinuation of football, we anticipate graduation rates will dip for the next several years, which leads us to focus greater attention on our first year retention rates. Next slide, please. We implemented two new programs last year to help increase retention. The first was a new student success center that centers diversity, equity, and belonging as essentially intertwined with student success efforts. The second was implementation of two first-year seminar courses. The first course includes modules addressing study skills, equity and inclusion, career exploration, financial literacy, and health and wellness, while the second course takes a deeper dive into critical thinking as faculty engaged students in equity-related topics ranging from the Farm Bill to sustainability and food insecurity to organizational decision-making. Results from the first year are encouraging. First-gen students and students from Greater Minnesota continued to excel. Retention rates improved for students from low-income families, and perhaps most importantly, the retention rate gap between BIPOC students and white students was significantly narrowed. Next slide, please. Crookston's move to test optional holistic review was grounded in data and intended to enhance our admission standards. Retention data for first year students admitted in 2019, our last year using the ACT, are instructive. In most cases, ACT scores and GPAs are highly correlated, meaning that we really only need one or the other of the two measures. However, where this becomes interesting is when the ACT score is either significantly higher or lower than one would expect given high school GPA. Data for our 2019 students in terms of retention were really instructive. For all of our students with a high school GPA of 3.35 or higher, our retention rate was 80.3%. However, for students with a higher ACT or with a lower ACT, an ACT below 20, the retention rate actually increased to 82.4%. The opposite was also true. For students with a high school GPA of 3.20 or lower, our retention rate was 64.5%. However, for those students who had an ACT of 23 or better, our retention rate dropped to 62.5%. The implication is that high school grades at Crookston are a much better predictor of student success, and our move to test optional helped us to raise the bar in terms of the grades of our incoming students. Regarding student demographics, we saw a significant increase in first generation students on our campus. And while the overall percentage of BIPOC students appears to have dropped by 2%, our 2019 number without football was 17%. So we actually increased by 2% this year. We were lastly somewhat surprised by the greater Minnesota numbers and the drop there, though part of the explanation for this is a larger number of greater Minnesota students who went to other institutions within the state. And as I see that my time here is running short, let me quickly on the last slide highlight three additional aspects of our plan. First, renewed attention to online students has yielded positive results, and we intend to do more in the coming years. Second, we are heavily investing in marketing and efforts, including those targeting signature programs and those that are coordinated with system level initiatives. And lastly, given the anticipated drop in high school graduates between 2025 and 2030, we're investing now in pathway programs with late elementary, middle school, and early high school students with a concerted focus on students from historically underrepresented populations. With that, thank you, and I'll pass on to my colleague at Duluth.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate that, John. We're going to go to Executive Vice Chancellor Delgado from our House of Weather up in Minnesota's Port City today. Vice Chancellor.
Chair Anderson, it's always beautiful in Duluth.
Go ahead, sir.
Thank you, Chair Anderson, and for the opportunity to update the board on enrollment challenges and responses to this COVID-affected moment, or as Provost Croson likes to refer to it, COVID-adjusted moment. Committee members may recall that some of the content I will cover today, and that is in your docket materials, was covered at greater length and in more detail during the March 2020 meeting held at Duluth. However, as we look at slide one, we can see that the impact of COVID has accelerated challenges to our enrollment, both to new students and in our retention efforts. These uncertainties created by COVID have also greatly impacted UMD's efforts to recruit out of state and certainly our internationalization efforts. These challenges suggest that UMD will have to correct its five-year enrollment plan and revise its predictions downward for targeted student enrollment by 2023. Now that we have our COVID-adjusted enrollment for the fall of 2020, we are beginning the work to reassess what the next 3 years might look like for UMD. Next slide, please. As slide two notes, there is tremendous competition for students and there are significant resource challenges associated with COVID's impacts on our budgets. You may recall as well that UMD comes into the 2021 fiscal year having already recorded $5.2 million in budget cuts for the current year. And like the rest of the university, we are extremely cautious about budget shortfalls this year and moving into next year. In addition, UMD is perhaps more vulnerable to something like COVID because its brand and identity are so tied to location and in-person learning and social experiences. The projected budget impact on UMD has caused us to pause some of our hiring and programming. And in critical areas like financial aid and admissions, we see the prevalence of vacancies going through this academic year, greatly impacting our capacity to recruit the fall 2021 class. Next slide, please. Retention and graduation rates fortunately have been steady or trending upward, and we anticipate seeing this positive slope continue. As you can see in the materials provided, central academic and collegiate units have invested in initiatives aimed at student success, and the student life division's efforts at building a wellness initiative are having an impact, notwithstanding COVID. Next slide. As you can see, many of these student focus initiatives that are delineated in the slide cut across academic and student life areas. I would like to highlight the changes to academic support courses, which are now in 5-week module forms, thus allowing for flexibility and to allow students to opt out if the student no longer demonstrates a need. Also, you will see wellness as a linchpin for student life, but also a crosswalk with some collegiate units focus on personal strengths development. Lastly, we have included our active learning efforts that are visible across all 4 colleges, but a particular focus in the Swenson College of Science and Engineering. In addition, UMD's academic colleges, pre and post-COVID, have a commitment to connecting learning to community by using the Twin Ports region as a site for academic study and research, thus creating yet one more opportunity for students to extend their learning beyond the classroom. Next slide, please. Finally, we are moving into a test optional environment beginning with this admission cycle. In this way, UMD follows a lot of public and private institutions into this space. For UMD, this means the beginning of a learning process about potential student profiles and a redoubling of our commitment to a holistic admissions process aimed at diversifying our student body while targeting students with a likelihood of success at UMD. We see test optional not as an extra burden, but as a call to look at the totality of the student and assess how that student might fit at UMD and how UMD might best support that student through their access, success, and graduation routes to the university. Next slide, please. And like our system colleagues, UMD will remain committed to student access, positive student experiences, and academic success, no matter where our students come from. UMD's focus has always been on outstanding academic opportunities and a comprehensive approach to students' personal development. And as you can see by the density of the slide, we have no shortage of initiatives and focus areas across all of the academic and student support areas. I will cut my presentation here, Chair Anderson, and thank you for your time, and pass it on to my colleague from the University of Minnesota, Morris.
Appreciate that, Vice Chancellor Delgado. So we're gonna go to Interim Vice Chancellor Burt from Minnesota Morris, and as you know, that's not far from where I live, so I assume the weather is beautiful in Morris today. Go ahead when you're ready.
The sun is shining, so yes, I call that beautiful. So thank you, Chair Anderson and members of the committee for this opportunity to provide you with an update on Morris's 5-year enrollment plan. I'll also speak briefly about successes and challenges as we look toward 2021 and beyond. So the University of Minnesota Morris's 5-year enrollment plan was endorsed by the Board of Regents in February 2019 and aligns both with the campus's strategic plan, which was completed in 2019, and the system-wide strategic plan. Our 5-year enrollment plan was ambitious even before the COVID-19 pandemic, and this unexpected challenge has impacted the campus's ability to enroll and retain the number of students planned for fall 2020. This will set back the timeline for us to achieve our enrollment goals as originally presented in our 5-year plan, and we will adjust our timeline this academic year. UMN Morris has historically experienced fluctuating enrollment levels, and the campus remains committed to stabilizing enrollment at 1,700 students, which we believe will better support the campus's long-term goals and sustainability. Morris has planned and implemented numerous changes that the campus anticipates will lead to increased student enrollment. One example is the campus's first strategic enrollment management plan. Work on this effort commenced last November. The plan's goals and strategies were finalized this past spring, and priority tactics this fall. Although the transfer student pool has been shrinking overall, UMN Morris is committed to both enrolling more transfers and better serving those that have already matriculated. This summer, the campus was awarded a new NASANTI, or Native American Serving Non-Tribal Colleges, collaborative grant, the focus of which includes strengthening relationships with and pathways for students between several tribal colleges and UMN Morris. In addition to that effort, plans are underway to complete institutional articulation agreements and to develop clear pathways for transfer students through to graduation from UMN Morris. The campus is committed to continuing its established partnerships with international institutions and will continue to seek out opportunities to return its international student population to previous levels. While it is unlikely that international student enrollments will increase significantly in the near term, UMN Morris continues to be committed to exploration of new avenues to enhance international enrollments on the Morris campus. Next slide, please. So there's a lot listed here, and I will only discuss a few due to our time constraints. We have provided additional information in the docket materials. As a residential liberal arts college, central features of our educational model have been greatly impacted by the pandemic. In a university community that is small and close-knit, disruption of the ability to deepen relationships, interact informally, and engage with other community members in person has been consequential, both in terms of new and continuing student enrollment. In July 2019, Chancellor Baer announced key organizational changes in the area of enrollment management, including the creation of an Office of Transfer Student Services. We call it TSS. You need an acronym for everything. Currently, over 70% of our students enter UMN Morris with college-level course experience, either as new high school students with college credits or as students transferring from 2 and 4 year campuses. The need for intentional transfer student support had been noted by campus committees over the last decades and more recently highlighted as a significant need by external consultants. The TSS director hiring committee identified finalists for the position in March, at which point the position was placed on hold. Next slide, please. So as we take a look at this, our first to second year retention rates for new high school students have remained fairly consistent over the last 6 years at around 80%. Our strategic enrollment management plan includes effort designed to increase our first to second year retention rate. Our ultimate goal is to get closer to 90%. I will describe some of these efforts later in the presentation. UMN Morris's graduation rates have remained relatively steady over the last few years, with a 4-year graduation rate around 50% and a 6-year graduation rate around 65%. Recent success includes a narrowing of the 4-year graduation gap between American Indian and white students for the latest cohort available. And we've noted before that we have had a number of grants connected to trying to do exactly that. So it's exciting to see that that narrowing take place. Next slide, please. As mentioned earlier, the campus has implemented a number of changes to provide improved student support, and a few examples are shown here. In summer 2020, the campus piloted a change in its summer registration process. Instead of grouping students with faculty to complete their course selections, incoming students were provided one-on-one professional advising with their first-year success coach. This effort allowed students to make early connections with their success coaches and allowed deeper relationships to be established from the beginning of their career at Morris. Overall response to the pilot has been very positive. One of the campus's strategic plan priorities is to develop a first-year experience course, which is being piloted this academic year. The course connects students with developmentally appropriate resources and support. We also plan to add a transfer student section in the future. Morris's commitment to improving student success is reflected in its strategic enrollment management goals, as I note at the bottom there. By clearly embedding the principles of the liberal arts into the pathways students take toward careers and other postgraduate outcomes, we will help both prospective and current students and families better understand the depth of the Morris experience and also provide guideposts for success toward completing a degree and preparing for one's future. Next slide, please. The Morris campus is not requiring standardized test scores for spring 2021 nor fall 2021 domestic applicants. The Office of Admissions will continue to use a holistic admissions review process and will evaluate the impact of not requiring test scores on the number of applications submitted and applicant demographics after the completion of the fall 2021 cycle. The campus will also conduct an evaluation of the predictive value of the ACT on student success at Morris. Next slide, please. UMN Morris has confidence in the extensive efforts it has put into place to enhance student success, including its strategic enrollment management plan. However, we must acknowledge that uncertainties related to COVID-19 and its aftermath continue to present challenges to fully implementing some of the efforts that are essential to the plan's success, such as the development of robust new initiatives to bolster and transfer student support that I mentioned earlier. Additionally, the campus strongly believes that successful system-wide enrollment efforts are an essential component of its future success. And we are excited about the current system-wide marketing initiative, which, as you heard earlier, is designed to increase statewide awareness of the distinctive advantages of each campus in the system, including ours. And next, I believe that Vice Chancellor Ratliff Crane will speak about the Rochester campus.
Thank you, Vice Chancellor Burt. Vice Chancellor Ratliff Crane, whenever you're ready, we'll move down to Rochester, beautiful southeast Minnesota.
Absolutely, a beautiful sunny day here today. Thank you, Chair Anderson and members of the board for this opportunity to provide an update on the enrollment status at the Rochester campus. Regarding the five-year enrollment plan, UMR's five-year enrollment plan, which was approved spring of 2019, was set into place in 2015, so we are reaching the end of that plan. This is supplemented by the UMR Blufftop View Growth Plan, which was also approved in spring of 2019. As noted in the docket materials, the plan aligns with the system-wide strategic plan, specifically regarding commitments 1, 2, and 4, the student success, discovery, innovation, and impact, and community and belonging commitments respectively. The Rochester campus has achieved and aims to sustain equity in student educational attainment as we grow, and our faculty focus their primary research on student learning and development with the aim to adapt practice based on research results and provide solutions to Minnesota's inequities in educational attainment. For commitment 3, the mentor section's focus area to drive innovation for next generation health, the looming and dramatic healthcare force gap in Minnesota, and in light of our ongoing learning from the current pandemic related disruptions, has moved the UMR campus to combine our high-touch relational educational model with higher tech to develop diverse talent with a next-gen M pilot that contributes to enrollment growth and explores a new model of distributed learning. The board will learn more about that as well. And lastly, regarding commitment 5, fiscal stewardship, UMR's continued commitment to public-private partnerships and other means for efficient delivery of education remains our guide. The return on investment for Rochester is high. The pace of enrollment growth at the Rochester campus, however, will be determined by the system's capacity and willingness to invest seed money, as was requested and approved in the Blufftop View Plan, and potentially other new revenue sources. UMR is on track for our five-year target and rapidly meeting our bold enrollment goals ahead of schedule. With over 10% enrollment increase over last year, UMR's undergraduate enrollment is now at 632, with 614 degree-seeking students, compared to a 2021 goal of 700. Including graduate enrollments in the bioinformatics and computational biology graduate programs and professional and partnership programs in occupational therapy and in nursing, the total student count is 910, ahead of the 2021 enrollment plan goal of 900, and approaching the 2025 Blufftop bold goal of 1,000. Next slide, please. Some challenges. Visibility and name recognition remain probably one of our bigger challenges. We are making gains, as evidenced by our recruiting successes, but have room still to grow, as the system enrollment marketing study confirmed. The system enrollment marketing efforts are a very welcome addition to our work to build visibility and reputation, as is the Share My App opportunity. Economic factors, especially in the current climate, remain a concern. We are at capacity for student housing, but needed to delay a planned residence project because of financial uncertainties with a planned partner. Scholarship allocations available to students remained nearly flat despite our increase in students with high financial need by both percent and by number. This remains our primary recruiting obstacle, as well as a threat to retention and completion. funding for planned additional faculty and staff lines to support a growing student population have likewise been delayed. Lastly, we value the partnerships we have with the university and are actively pursuing new ones, but this has been a slow process. Next slide, please. Regarding student success, as the graphs show, our graduation retention rates wobble up and down, but remain a pretty consistent line. With small overall enrollments, a few students one way or another makes a difference. I'm happy to report improvements in both four-year graduation and first and second-year retention rates for 2020 based on preliminary estimates. The 2020 four-year graduation rate increased 6% to 56% compared to 2019. On the slide is reference to the fact that students who did begin their matriculate to UMR and complete their degree at UMR, 100% of those students did complete their degrees in 4 years or fewer. But we do need to acknowledge that, again, the overall graduation rate for incoming students was at 50% last year, 56% this year. First-year retention for the 2019 cohort also increased from the 79% that appears on the slide for the 2018 cohort to 82% for the 2019 cohort. Second-year retention likewise increased to 72% from 68% from the preceding cohort. The ability and care of our faculty to effectively pivot to an online environment in spring and prepare for an effective fall is an important element to this retention success. Retention and graduation rates are both areas we strive to improve, and we're currently engaged in a multi-pronged analysis to best understand predictors for retention and success. We will never reach the same retention rates seen at elite liberal arts colleges, for example, because a shift from a healthcare and sciences major means leaving UMR. However, through partnerships and our focus on career pathways, showing broad directions achievable with a high science, health sciences degree, students are finding broader possibilities with this interdisciplinary, customizable degree. The other barriers, as noted before, are the financial realities. Nearly half of our scholarships are currently only for the first year, presenting financial hardships on completion. We're successfully pursuing more four-year scholarship dollars, but this is a vital area for investment for our students. Next slide, please. A UMR education is designed with universal access and application of student supports and opportunities fully in mind. From reliance on flipped course delivery to employing student success coaches who provide holistic academic, career, and life coaching for students' time at UMR, all students are provided a rich environment for learning and development. All students engage in research, community-based learning, and more, culminating in a comprehensive capstone experience. This wraparound support promotes learning, success, and a means for career and personal development expected within a residential higher education experience. Next slide, please. Regarding admissions tests, ACT test scores are not a requirement for the fall 21 class currently being recruited. Given the continued testing challenges because of COVID, this remains the right choice with regard to student access. We are conducting deep analyses into predictors of persistence and success, and based on those analyses, we will make recommendations in the future regarding standardized tests for future recruitment. Next slide, please. UMR was able to recruit a strong class for fall 2020 before the pandemic placed a strain. A combination of positive momentum, outstanding work by our admissions team, and building reputation brought us into a strong position. Our student life, success, and engagement team were successful in making an engaged registration and orientation process for the transition to UMR, mitigating potential melt. We're concerned about the upcoming year for recruitment because of impacts on college fairs, travel, and campus visits, but despite that, applications are starting strong. We'll discuss diversity efforts more in February, but we are proud of our success with traditionally underrepresented students. Students of color, first-generation college students, and or Pell-eligible students consistently make up nearly two-thirds of our incoming students. We have a responsibility to apply the best pedagogical research to the success of all of our students. Finally, we continue to innovate. We're exploring how the current disruption can be a catalyst for further innovation in ways that align with the system-wide strategic plan commitments. Our Next Gen M initiative, which will be described at a later meeting as the chancellors describe how campus plans align with system-wide strategic plan. With that, I turn it over to Bob McMaster and on the Twin Cities.
Thank you, Vice Chancellor. So though there's Vice Provost McMaster on my screen, so we're gonna turn it over to the enrollment cleanup hitter, Vice Provost McMaster. Go ahead, sir.
Good, thank you, Jeff. Chair Anderson, members of the committee, today I'll provide an update on the Twin Cities Enrollment Plan. This plan was originally presented to the Board of Regents in 2016 with an update to the board in 2018. By necessity, I'll have to skim the surface of our plan in the next 8 minutes, but we'll try to hit some of the major points. I cannot cover all 10 parts of the plan, but want to comment on several of the UMTC priorities. In a moment, I'll provide the enrollment model that has guided our work for the past 5 years. We'll likely need to consider extending our timeline given the recent enrollment trends that we'll discuss. We also have several efforts to ensure that we'll continue to focus on enhancing our diversity. That's one of the priorities here. And in fact, we reach an all-time high of 28% students of color and American Indian students in the fall 2020 class. Next slide. This slide depicts the UMTC enrollment plan out to fall 2024. The model, which includes projections for both freshmen and transfer students, assumes we will build to a total undergraduate enrollment of approximately 33,000 by 2024. Right now, we're at about 30,500. As we've discussed, the transfer pool has been softening for a number of years, and it is now unlikely we will be able to enroll 2,300 transfer students each fall moving forward, especially with the decreasing enrollments in the Minnesota state system. It also may be that over the next few years, it'll be difficult to reach the 6,000 or 6,100 freshman target, depending on the impact of the pandemic. Next slide. It is uncertain how far beyond 2024 we will need to grow the undergraduate student body to get to the 33,000. The positive news is that our improved retention and graduation rates have resulted in students completing their degrees at a faster rate, thus emptying out of the pipeline at a quicker pace. The next slide identifies some of the key enrollment challenges we face in the next few years. Three I would like to mention are the rapidly changing geodemographic landscape that we have discussed on numerous occasions, including last June, both at the regional and national level. The intense competition for NR&R students, given the tendency, at least in the short term, for students to stay closer to home, and the significant uncertainty with international enrollment, where we were down significantly over last year. It is also clear that the reciprocity states have been working even harder to retain their own high school students as well as enroll Minnesota residents. Next slide. The next slide provides the UMTC student success metrics. Our first year retention continues above 93%. And for the class of 2019, the rate currently stands at 93.6, an all-time high. Our goal here is to reach 94% over the next few years. The UMTC four-year rate has risen above 72%, and the six-year rate is now over 84%. In particular, these two graduation rates put us in a very good position compared to our peer institutions. The UMTC also continues to improve the rates for our students of color and American Indian students. And again, we'll be reporting more on that in February. I'd also like to point to one other number here, which may be Regent Anderson's favorite number, and that's the three-year graduation rate, is now up to 9.5%. Next slide. The UMTC continues with myriad student success initiatives. One of the more exciting initiatives is the creation of a series of dashboards to enable near real-time monitoring of student progress. These dashboards indicate student progress towards degree credits, overall credits, and can identify students who are off course for timely graduation. The UMTC has created a new academic alert system where faculty can provide academic progress updates, mostly grade data, to both students and their advisors, enabling identification of concerning grades or trends. Finally, we have provided detailed DFW reports to departments that provide rich disaggregated data for various student groups. Next slide. As the board knows, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, the UMTC will not require a test score for the incoming class of 2021. We're in that process right now. In the Office of Undergraduate Education and Office of Admissions, we have been discussing the next steps for the use of standardized test scores. We are finalizing a white paper analysis that is under review now and will be circulated in the very near future. Based on this assessment, the next two slides identify a few of the positives and negatives around the use of test scores. Some of the factors that argue for the continued use of test scores include enhanced ability to predict student success in college, the problematic future of class rank as a metric, and the ability to use subscores for placement purposes. Next slide. Some of the negatives around the use of test scores include the prediction accuracy of tests in the admissions process by themselves without a holistic process, the richer grade information that will allow a much deeper analysis of course taking and success that's now possible, and the economic disparity concern for access to standardized tests and test prep. Our office will continue to look at the existing studies and literature as we move towards a decision on the use of test scores for the class of 2022 and beyond. Next slide. Finally, this slide presents some of the additional factors that affect enrollment management on the Twin Cities campus. A major focus must be on affordability, and in particular on increasing the scholarships and gift aid for our students. The recently announced Benson Challenge will provide a $15 million match, which means donors will provide substantially more for our lowest income students system-wide. The transfer landscape will have to be carefully analyzed over the next few months. We must enhance this pipeline and ensure the transfer to the UMTC allows for a simple and smooth transition to our campus. Related to this, I'd like to also mention the role of the State of Minnesota P20 Council. The council brings together many of the key groups in the world of education in our state, including the University of Minnesota, Minnesota State, and the Minnesota Offices of Education and Higher Education in order to exchange ideas, provide coordination among the various bodies. The council discusses topics such as dual credit, educational metrics, transfer, degree completion goals. So it's a very important body for coordinating all aspects of education in the state. With that summary, I'd like to turn presentation back to Provost Croson. Thank you very much.
Provost Croson, did you want to tie us up here and figure it all out, tie all this information together, and then we'll go to questions?
Super. Thank you, Chair Anderson and members of the board. I mostly want to thank all of our presenters and all of the staff that I know was behind them in collecting and presenting this data in a way that could be a lot of data, but hopefully in a way that could be digestible and comparable across campuses. And so with that, we're happy to take your questions.
Terrific. Great job, presenters. You know, my actual clock here says you guys did that in 6:32, less time than we actually allocated. So you are to be congratulated, and I appreciate that. And I'm hoping we have a lot of questions here and you'll get to answer more questions. Regent McMillan, you're first on my list.
Wow, thank you, Chair Anderson, and thank you to the team that just walked through this. I have a number of comments, and I'll try and circle back with two questions here. But first of all, thank you to President Gable and Provost Croson and the team for encouraging and continuing to bring a system-wide conversation to this critical area. 5 years ago, we would never have had all five campuses here talking about this at the same time with an open and frank discussion about the challenges that that come from and opportunities that hopefully spawn from a system-wide look. So really important dialogue. The first comment I have is that I've said this before, but nobody needs to reply to this unless President Cable wants to, but we've got to have a statewide demand supply analysis at some point. I don't think there's any question we've got overcapacity in the four-year space, and we've got declining demand, and those high school demographics just aren't good. So I don't know when or how we do that, but that's got to happen. Nobody needs to reply to that. That's just a theme I'm going to keep raising because I think it has to be, and I don't know how we do system-wide enrollment planning without a good sense of what a data-driven approach to it. So secondly, at least two of these presentations openly pointed out that UMTC's expanded and more aggressive recruitment has impacts at other places. That was clear in Morris and clear in Duluth. So materials, and again, back to my opening comment, it's important that we're okay talking about that, but I don't know what we do about it, but clearly there are real financial consequences as the Twin Cities goes down below the levels it had typically gone and expands its recruiting efforts. So again, if someone's got an idea there or how we go about dealing with that, it's good to get it on the table. What to do about it, I don't know. Now here come the questions. What in the student success metric area could we be looking at as we try to improve upon Regent Beeson's now old work, but important work to put maroon and gold measures together? There's clearly a clear connection, a cause and effect between GPAs, ACTs, and four-year graduation rates. And as we deal with that declining enrollment or declining demographic out of high school, we're going to be going lower into the ACT and GPA pool in all likelihood. I don't know that for sure. But what other metrics could we as a board look at? Would it be tutors per student, advisors per some measure of student, class sizes? The Crookston presentation talked about the GPA relationship. We've typically focused on ACT. I think you as a leadership team need to help us understand where you think those connections are. And then if we're going to judge these campuses on how they're doing with student success, we've got to find the resources to help fund that if there are ways that we should be driving that. Last comment, and perhaps a place for a question, as the demand declines for the service we sell, i.e. education, I think we've got to look really closely at our pricing models at each of these campuses, whether they're a regional comprehensive campus, whether they're a public or and residential small liberal arts college. There are different price points for all of those things, and I know some of my colleagues have wanted to focus on price at the Twin Cities. To me, that is a distant second to price at these campuses that are facing the stiffest competition for that declining enrollment. So I think the most cogent place for a question and answer there would be the student success metrics. But if President Gable wanted to comment on any of the others or any of the presenters, that'd be great. Thank you, Regent Anderson.
President Gable, do you want to take a question on the success metrics, or do we want to throw that over to Provost Croson?
Thank you, Chair Anderson, Regent McMillan. I'll start, and then I imagine Provost Croson will have some of the detail. But a couple of things to keep in mind is that we do need to do some analysis, both at the state level and probably in the reciprocity region, the areas where we recruit the most of our students. I mean, this is something that everyone's admissions team on each of the campuses does in different ways as part of their projection around how to identify potential students, and clearly the circumstances of the day catalyze our need to be even more data-driven about how we identify our audience, broadly speaking, and where our opportunities lie to serve students in Minnesota and to attract students into Minnesota and then hopefully keep them here and turn them into Minnesotans, which is something that is also part of our mission. How we measure what we're doing, what's interesting about what you said is there's really bookends to this. So there's the criteria we use to project the likelihood of success, and circumstances are hitting those really hard. I mean, and that's bringing up this conversation around testing and test optional in fundamentally new ways, and how, when we can't offer the test, what we do and what will that mean long-term? Will the market open up and an alternative will emerge? And those are questions that in this space we're all having very robustly, immediately, and probably for the next few years. And then there is, what do we do once students are on campus? That's the not the projection, but the reality. And there are a lot of different ways to approach this. Some of this is driven by the individual culture of the campus. And so you heard each person from each campus describing a campus climate and a set of services on each campus and a way of meeting students where they are on each campus that varies to reflect the type of educational environment that each campus has. And they are pulling their levers back and forth to see what works and what doesn't work based on who they are and what they do and what they teach. And then there are things that are happening nationally, trendline-wise, like artificial intelligence and big data and identifying trends very early. You know, there are tools that are really very nuanced, like, you know, where there are certain freshman level classes where we can use big data to see that a student who performs at X level on X test in X class actually has X probability of being successful when they're a senior upon graduation. These things get really rich, and thinking about what we would do there. How that translates into maroon and gold measures, it's a very interesting time for us to have that conversation because it's shifting in real time. So we'll set maroon and gold measures probably driven more by outcomes than by what we will do to meet those outcomes, but we will be underneath the maroon and gold measures, I suspect, changing a lot year over year as the data comes online and as this group of students comes in having been assessed differently than what our historical data would allow us to assess them as for admission, and then watching them as they arrive and supporting them as they arrive in new ways and seeing what that means. So I suspect maroon and gold won't look that different than it does now, but the things that would feed up to maroon and gold will probably be quite different.
Thank you, Provost Croson. Anything to add or?
So I just want to reiterate something President Gable said about using artificial intelligence and big data in order to inform us. I think that's a really unique opportunity that didn't exist 5 to 10 years ago. I also think that the level of comfort of students with interactions with technology has changed significantly. And so when I was in college, it was all about face-to-face advising. And now students want to talk to an advisor virtually. They want to interact with their peers via text. They want to get updates from their faculty member on Facebook, right? So everybody's, so this way that one keeps students engaged and motivated and on track can differ. And so I think we need to be responsive to that, not simply continuing to invest in the current models, which are good things to do, but also to explore the new and innovative ways to enhance student success.
Thank you.
Thank you. I just had a chuckle when you talked about when you were in college. Well, when I was in college, my capstone paper was done with a chisel and a rock. So it changed over, you know, in my day too. So we're gonna keep moving here. You know, we got a lot of time. I've hardly ever said that. That's one of the reasons I like going to this more depth, less topic, more in depth. Just so you know, we're going to have Regent Hsu, Regent Davenport, Regent Mayron, Regent Powell, and Regent Beeson, and Regent Svigum in that order, and there may be room for more. So let's move on to Regent Hsu.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, presenters. I just have a few questions here, and I'll just start out. Regarding the Morris campus, I was wondering if we could get some more information on the challenge related to the dedicated funds for the American Indian tuition waiver. How much are we talking about? How much progress are we making towards getting dedicated funding for that, and how we're doing that? That's been a topic for years. Regarding Rochester, I'm looking at your current numbers, and I only see 614 students, undergrad students, full time. I'm wondering if you could discuss that, since it's quite a bit below what was in the presentation. And then regarding the Twin Cities, the numbers that I see split between men and women are 53.1% now versus 46.7% men. And was wondering if you could give me an idea about how we're looking in terms of admissions and offers, and how we get down to that number in terms of actual enrollment. And then lastly, regarding Minnesota students, I'm glad we're looking at test optional, but one thing that I suggested years ago that I didn't hear any mention of was like a top 10% admissions, automatic admissions for Minnesota students. And, you know, pick a number, whether it's 10% or top 1%. I think it's important to look for that. In the past, I was told that those numbers don't exist, whereas in fact they do exist, and every school district has a computer system, whether or not they print it out on this transcript or not, they do know who's in the top percent, 10% of the class, because they have a annual dinner usually for the top percent of graduates. So I guess I'll leave it there. I'll look forward to answers. Thank you.
Regent Hsu, if I hear you correct, and just give me a moment here, we're gonna go to Vice Chancellor Burt about dedicated funding, Vice Chancellor Ratliff Crane about number of students at Rochester, the true number. And then I think those last two, Vice Provost McMaster can probably tackle. Is that okay?
Sure, thank you.
Okay, Vice Chancellor Burt, if you would.
Thank you, Regent Hsu and Chair Anderson. So regarding the American Indian Tuition Waiver, first of all, we are very committed to our to all students, but also to the relationship that we have, the unique relationship we have with American Indian students, given our history as an American Indian boarding school. We continue to have discussions at the state and federal levels in terms of figuring out ways to better fund the waiver. And we're also working with other Nisanti institutions to enhance financial support for Morris and other institutions like Morris. In terms of the specifics, we could provide you more detail. We track all the information and know how what a financial impact it has on our campus. And so we can provide that information if you would like.
Thank you. Vice Chancellor Ratliff Crane on the numbers at Rochester, please.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, thank you, Regent Hsu, for that question. So absolutely, our new high school student count, or our degree-seeking student count is 614, which I did also report in the presentation. I think the numbers can get a little muddled as we started throwing them all in there. Adding in our non-degree-seeking students, so that includes PSEO and others, that brings it to the 632. Notably, for our Blufftop View plan and growth plan that we actively include in our graduate professional and partnership programs, and that's where we get to the 910 that I shared. So all those numbers are absolutely relevant regarding and descriptive of our student environment, but is also reflective of the unique elements of the way that UMR operates. Does that help?
Thank you, sir. Vice Provost McMaster, I remember one was on the top 10%. I can't remember what the other one was on, but you maybe have it written down. If you'd go ahead, please. Please unmute.
apologies. I got remuted at some point in that. Chair Anderson and Regent Hsu, thanks for the question. In terms of the gender balance, Regent Hsu, just a little data here that I pulled on that. Over the last 3 years, for fall 2018 in the freshman class, 44% of the class were males. In fall 19, that had risen to about 45.5. This year for fall 2020, based on the census, about 47% of the class were males. So that number has been nudging up. I just wanted to mention that. I don't have data in front of me for the two groups in terms of admissions or applications and then offers for each of the two groups. I do have just some basic metric on each that plays into this, I think. The average GPA for female applicants, this is for 2020 Regent Hsu, was 3.6, and the average GPA for males, for males was 3.48. So the women had slightly higher GPAs, which certainly could have contributed to the higher admit rate. I can certainly go out and try to pull kind of the application offer data as well, but we do see a slight upward trend. I think probably 4 or 5 years ago, the imbalance was at about 54% to 46%. So that's been leveling off a bit. In terms of the top 10%, over 50% of schools don't present us with a rank for their students. So if the schools have a rank, our admissions office does not get it. And so that's become a problem for us in the use of high school rank as a metric. You indicated that the data is out there and there are awards ceremonies and other mechanisms to identify these. I'd have to talk with our admissions office and see what their knowledge is about that. So as of now, we just don't have the data to use. The second point here is we still believe that holistic review that uses both the primary metrics, ACT, not next year, grades, rigor of the curriculum, high school rank when we have it, as well as all the secondary factors around a student's success in high school, is still the best model and the national standard for admitting students to the University of Minnesota. So again, as we get into this year of test optional or not requiring a test, I think a lot of this will be discussed, but that's kind of where we are on that question. Thank you.
Regent Hsu, does that in a large scope answer your questions?
Yes, thank you. I just want to point out that I've had a lot of discussions with school boards and superintendents about the class rank. Really, what we've been on is a kind of trend where parents don't want their kids' class ranks known if they're below 10%, the top 10%, but they do want them known if they're above the top 10%. So every school district does record that information. They can figure it out. They can send a letter to our admissions department if necessary. And I think, you know, the fact that the information does seem to be out there, that we could use it in the future as a consideration of enrollment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Regent Hsu. Thank you, Chancellors. Regent Davenport, please.
Thank you, Chair Anderson and presenters. It certainly is a challenging time. I want to recognize the positive impact of student scholarships on enrollment and ask, and on a scale of 1 to 10, just a number, no elaboration, how challenging are your overall student scholarship development challenges? And again, on the same 1 to 10 scale, 1 being not a challenge, 10 being highly challenged, what is your capacity to pursue additional student scholarships?
Provost Croson, do you I don't have the answer.
Regent Davenport, Chair Anderson, thank you for the question. I'm not sure I would be comfortable answering for each campus. You want a campus by campus, or you're looking for an overall?
Regent
How about just a number? How about just a number campus by campus? No elaboration.
All right, so let's go around to the campuses.
Let's start with Chancellor Hoffman.
8 or a 9.
Chancellor Delgado.
4.
4. Okay. Chancellor Burt.
I think I understand the question, Regent Davenport. So I would go 6.
Vice Chancellor Ratliff Crane.
I appreciate the question. It is a, we're at a 9. It's a significant concern for us.
Okay. And Vice Provost McMaster?
For the first question, I would estimate a 5. And for the second question, I would estimate a 7.
Okay. I guess if that's where you're looking, numerical, where they are on that 10-point scale, got, you know, from a 4 to a 9. So we've got a range there. Anything else, Regent Davenport?
No, thank you for that. That's a good snapshot.
Thank you very much. Regent Mayron.
Yes, thank you. I have a question for Crookston and a question for the Twin Cities presentation. My question for Vice President Chancellor Hoffman, on slide 55, when you were talking about, I'm telling you, in our deck here, it was page 55, student success. And you indicated that the upcoming graduation rates will be negatively affected by the discontinuation of the football program. And I wanted to understand why the discontinuation of that program you believe will affect upcoming graduation rates. My second question was for Vice President Provost McMaster. And that has to do with slide 84. And there you indicated, the slide indicates that enrollment is complicated because of admission to 8 freshman colleges. And I wanted to get an understanding as to why it is complicated. And assuming that we will continue with that admission program, what your thoughts on it as to whether that on balance is still a good way to proceed.
Let's have Vice Chancellor Hoffman. You want to take that first crack, and then Vice Provost McMaster can go second.
Chair Anderson and Regent Mayron, thank you for the question. So with the discontinuation of our football program last fall, following that, we had approximately a little more than 80, 85 students in that program. The majority of those students, a few of them were seniors and they went on to graduate. Many of those students, though, had remaining eligibility. And so they have transferred out. Juniors, sophomores, first-year students have transferred to other programs to play football and complete their degrees. That means we have an unusual loss of students within that first year, second year, third year class from last year. And as those students will not be graduating from the University of Minnesota Crookston, we anticipate a drop in the graduation rates for those classes as they work their way through.
So it's because they're leaving school. I get it now too. It's their students leaving. Who is going to be next?
Can I, before we go.
Go ahead, Regent Mayron. Go ahead.
I'm glad you get it, Regent Anderson, but I'm not getting the, I must be thick here. So I'm not getting the connection. Isn't the graduation rate determined by those who are currently in the program as opposed to taking into account those who have left? Or are you saying it's impacted when you calculate graduation rates, you have to take into account all of those who left?
I believe that's what he's saying. Is that correct? Vice Chancellor?
Yes.
I understand. All right. Thank you.
Vice Provost McMaster.
Sure. I like this question, Chair Anderson and Regent Mayron. So we are unusual in the admissions process in that most of our peers have a gigantic arts and sciences college that brings in the majority of the undergraduate students. We have 8 freshmen admitting colleges spanning from CFANs, natural science and agriculture, to design, to nursing, to engineering. And so as we admit to each one of these colleges, each has a separate, really a separate set of metrics and almost a separate set of recruiters that are there to bring in students into design or into engineering. And so when students apply to the Twin Cities, they have a first choice major into a college and then a second choice major into a different college. And so as they shape the class, we try to get students into their first choice college based on their metrics and their interests and their backgrounds. And if they don't get in their first choice college, then we try to get them in their second choice college. So because of this, it's a much more complicated kind of admissions process than you'd have if you had one big arts and sciences college. I think it's an advantage. I think we get students coming here, Regent Mehran, because we have this fantastic College of Biological Sciences, which focuses on biology with very high metrics, or a College of Design, where you study intensively clothing design or interior design or retail merchandising or architecture. I view that as a strength in our admissions process, but it does make it more complicated. Thank you.
Any further questions, Regent Mehran?
No, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Regent Powell.
Thank you, Chair Anderson. I have a handful of questions. Can I fire off with the first two and then see if we've got time for a few more?
That would be fine.
Okay, thank you very much. The first question is for Mr. Ratcliffe Crane around Rochester. And we've seen before, you know, the projections that, you know, the opportunity, you know, for us could be, you know, up to 2,500 students or more. And really the question is, do we, you know, in terms of the kind of potential or market potential of our program in Rochester, do we still feel confident that 2,500 is an attainable number? And that's sort of part one. And then part two, you know, that's an exciting, you know, opportunity for us. Is, you know, have we kind of tightened down the sort of next step plan there, which I'm guessing is the plan that would get us to 1,500 students? I think, you know, this board would be very interested in seeing what kind of investment, you know, it will take, you know, over time to reach that goal. And so that's the first question for Mr. Ratcliffe Crane.
Go ahead, Mr. Ratcliffe, Vice Chancellor Ratcliffe Crane.
Yeah, Regent Powell, yes, thank you for that question. Absolutely, we do feel that number is ultimately attainable, and I think you're right that really beginning to look at the 1,500 is really our next goal. We don't want to overshoot capacity. We don't want to overshoot demand. We don't want to stretch where the need is, but we do know that there is the continuing need for students going into the healthcare sciences and healthcare professions, and we're providing a very nice conduit for that. Where our real challenge is more in capacity. I mean, we are, you know, as a residential campus and really wishing to have 95 to 100% of our first year students living on campus, we're at the point where we can't do that. And also have additional students, you know, returning students being able to do so, and many of them do wish to do that. We are reaching capacity in terms of our student success coaches and our faculty. And so part of an important part of the Blufftop View plan was indeed looking at investments to keep pace with the growth as it comes, to make sure that we're not bringing in more students than we're able to fully serve and meet at the levels that we expect and that they expect, but at the same time, do so in a planful way so we're not overshooting both, especially staffing, where there is obviously long-term financial commitment. So very stepwise way to that. Another is going back to the question with regard to scholarships, that ends up being another issue of capacity and need for us. I kind of rounded down by saying we had a need of 9, could have easily said 11. as we have shown an additional 10.5% increase in our undergraduate enrollment of last year to this year, we were only able to give out $2,000 more dollars in scholarship dollars this year. And that is really a capacity issue. It's really an issue that will impact not only continuing to attract students to move up to those aspirational numbers in terms of enrollment, but also has a major impact. And we're really looking at is the impact on their persistence and success. So does that answer
thank
your
you.
Question?
It does. Thank you. And given the importance of these medical professionals to the state, I think this region will be very interested in seeing, the details of the investments that it's going to take to keep us on that growth path. Second question, Chair. This one's for Vice President McMaster. It's really two quick ones. And the first one is kind of piggybacks on Regent Davenport's question on scholarships. And I guess I'm just would ask it a different way. You mentioned the Benson Scholarship. Maybe could you give us, a range or, some notion of, assuming that we want to support scholarships with private, with philanthropy, can you give us a range for, the kind of pool of money we think it would take us to really be fully competitive, with our regional peers in this scholarship area? And the second question has to do with international students that you mentioned last time at our last meeting, and I agree that we really do want to keep an international component within the university, but we've been highly dependent on really one country. Can you maybe give us a few thoughts on how we might diversify, and stabilize that international component? So those are the two.
Vice Provost McMaster.
Sure. Chair Anderson, Regent Powell, thanks again for that question. In terms of the scholarship world, I think it would be hard for me off the top of my head to come up with a number in terms of where we are. I can guarantee you if we wanted to address all of the unmet need for our students in an endowment, it would be billions of dollars that would be needed to do that. And so we realize that's never been a realistic kind of number to come up with, although the foundation has worked very hard to come up with a variety of scholarship programs. Instead, I can just identify the categories of need we have, and we address each one of these buckets in different ways. One is need-based, and so we've been trying to build up that capacity. The Benson is a great example of that, but there's also a whole array of other kinds of scholarship programs that piggyback off Pell, State Grant, or U of M Promise to try to get our students from, let's say, gift aid of 17, 18,000, maybe 20,000, up to the cost of attendance, which is 29,000. That's a very serious need for us. Another need is in middle income. And in many ways, the middle income students, and I think you've heard me say this before, struggle as much as the low income students because they're not packaged with a lot of Pell, State Grant, and U of M Promise and other scholarships. And so there are a series of middle income scholarships that have been developed over the last decade. The Larson would be an example of this, the Larson Scholarship Program, the Book Scholarship Program, the Johnson Scholarship Program. They really focus on middle income students, where middle income is identified as upper Pell, which is about 60,000 in AGI, adjusted gross income, up to 120. And that's kind of a board metric, the 120 that is the upper end of the U of M Promise program. in addition to that, I also have a priority of what I call merit-based scholarships, so that we are attracting the best and the brightest Minnesota students to stay in this state and not go out of state, because they're offered terrific packages at Princeton or at Michigan or at Berkeley. Those are students we still want to keep. And I couple that with support for our honors program and the goal of really better packaging the kind of scholarships that go for our honors students at the university. All of this also has to be put in the context that need and merit are it's a fuzzy boundary. Students often are meritorious. They come in with high academic metrics, very strong, but at the same time, there's strong need. So kind of looking across that in terms of the case statement we made with the board for undergraduate scholarships a number of years ago, those are the categories. And I think about filling up the bucket in terms of the amount of money in each one of those, realizing that in certain instances, it'll be filled through endowment. In other instances, it'll be filled through demand funds that we can spend more quickly. Long-winded answer, I'm sorry.
International students, second potential country other than China. Students,
our GPS office is well aware that our enrollments are strongly geographically based out of Asia, India, Korea, China, and they have recruiters that they're trying to recruitment programs are trying to develop for other parts of the world. The problem, one of the problems around this is if you think about Africa, for instance, or South America, you often don't have students with a lot of wealth there that are able to come to universities in the United States because of the cost. And so if we really want to diversify geographically, it's related to your first question. We have to really amp up the financial support we could provide for those students.
Thanks for the question, Chair Paul. No, any more?
I do have a few more, but why don't I wait and I'll see if there's time later. Thank you, Chair.
Okay. I was going to ask it kind of piqued my interest there about the international students and Vice Provost McMaster, I don't know if you know this history and you can tell me if it's correct, but in January, my wife and I were in Hawaii and we went out for coffee one day. And as I usually do, and she gets mad at me before I start talking to strangers. And turns out that the gentleman I was talking to was a retired chancellor president of the National University of Korea. And when I said I was from Minnesota, he said, well, we are so grateful to Minnesota, the University of Minnesota, for setting up our educational institutions. Evidently, after the Korean War, the University of Minnesota volunteered to go to Korea and help them with their educational system. Okay, so I would look at that as a target. I mean, he brought it up to me and he knew it right off the top of his head. So I would guess we have some leverage in some of those countries.
Well, to your point, Chair Anderson, Korea is one of our strongest markets in Asia.
Okay, thank you. We're gonna move on to Regent Beeson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, presenters. I know it's really hard to roll out and monitor a five-year plan when you're heavily focused just on every year's enrollment and the focus that requires. And I want to congratulate you all for landing a very respectable size class for 2020. So that's all good work and good presentation today. I do want to not to repeat Regent McMillan's comments, but I think they deserve some reinforcement. You know, it is important that we really break this enrollment strategy down by campus, like we are. They all have very different dynamics, require different strategies and different marketing approaches. Second, you know, we do need a better tuition differential strategy. And I've mentioned this several times about the need for a Western Minnesota strategy. It's been like crickets, though. I haven't had any response from two administrations and from, frankly, anybody, many people on the board. But if you're running a business and looking at these different departments and divisions, you would price them quite differently. And we know that Minneapolis Saints Hall is elastic. And I've said before, we have to have the courage to put more burden on the Twin Cities. I know that gets the headline and that gets people nervous, but the fact is we want these campuses to survive and prosper. We need to have a different pricing model. Third, the Regent McMillan's point about capacity, it is time to start the conversation about statewide capacity. I think I'm going to ask the chair, this is really a governance issue more than ask the president, but I think it's President or Chair Powell, going over and visiting the governor, taking along the chancellor. It's going to take several years to get that conversation moving, but it's time to really start that right now and just see what makes sense to do there. And then the other issue I want to mention, and Vice Chancellor Burt, you were asked by Regent Hsu about the American Indian tuition waiver. And I got to thinking about last year when historically Black colleges and universities received bipartisan support for funding from the federal government. And, American Indian boarding schools were devised by the federal government, but yet they don't participate in this funding. I think it's time to elevate the conversation sort of beyond sort of the people at Morris to have to do the heavy lifting, but it should be put on the agenda for whatever administration runs the government in January. And it's about the American Indian higher education strategy. This should be part of it. We are providing this education, providing it in large numbers. It's not insignificant cost. But I think we need to put it on our government relations staff federally to make this. Whoever is president, I think it may be both candidates will have an interest in it, but they have to know about the issue, but it's got to be sold through our senators and our people of Congress. I know we've tried, but it seems to me that has to be elevated as well. So good presentation. Thank you, staff, again, for all you did today and everything you do every day.
Thank you, Regent Beeson. Thank you. It's going to bring us to Regent Kenyanna. Is he there?
He is here.
He is there.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair Anderson. You didn't ask, but it's also a beautiful day here in the 3rd District.
Plymouth.
Maple Grove, but close enough. Okay. My comments were kind of taken, which is a good reason, which is a good thing, by Regent McMillan and just before me, Regent Beeson. But I, Mr. Chair, you did say we have time, so I'd be remiss not to take advantage of it. I just want to reiterate those things that were said. I think there's the administration and the campus leadership have done a great job on continually coming back and telling us their revised plans and the different initiatives they're putting into place. But these are things that are the board's responsibility, right? And if they're coming back every time saying that they did their part, I think the board has to do its. As Regent McMillan mentioned, at least two of the presentations cited the competition with the Twin Cities campus. And I know Vice Chancellor Hoffman talked about regional competition. I imagine you're referring to UND, that's just 30 miles, west and priced very similarly, right? We know UMD is also, the price difference between UMD and UM Twin Cities is pretty minimal. Our Minnesota State partners have capacity. PSEO is becoming increasingly popular, which is a great thing, but it means that when those students come in, they're staying longer. They're not staying longer. They're not staying longer. I did PSEO myself, but I still stayed for 4 years. I liked you guys that much. But essentially, my point is I've heard this conversation before, and everyone generally agrees that it's time to do what, Regent Beeson just called for. start that conversation at the state level, but then also at the system level, understand how the different things we're doing are, you know, intermixing and whatnot. But, you know, I think we'd be remiss if we were here a year from now and the vice chancellors were giving us their updated presentations saying we've done this, 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 and they were still pointing out these same things that are not in their purview and are not their responsibilities, but they're the administration's, but more than that, they're really the board's responsibility. So I just want to echo that call from Regent Beeson to our chair and also to my fellow members that we should start having this conversation with our partners at Minnesota State and at the state level. I understand that how unwieldy that kind of undertaking can be, and that when you start it, you don't necessarily control it, right? But I still think it needs to happen because the demand and supply pressures are either going to get to us one way or the other. So we should beat it, and also, you know, do our part as the administration and campus leadership has been doing theirs. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Regent Kenyanya. And that brings us up to Regent Simonson. And it's a beautiful day in Southwest Minnesota too, I guess, huh?
Yeah, it's very nice down here. Thank you. Thank you, Chair Anderson. Thank you, presenters. And I really appreciate the detailed list of the metrics you presented, graduation rates, retention, all of that. I think it's really good to look at this over time and what you're doing about it, making the adjustments like already been said. But a question kept coming to me as I was listening to this. So, okay, I have the degree. I have a four-year degree. Now what? And so it made me think about employment, metrics on employment or post-graduation or professional school. And does that have any impact on encouraging enrollment, especially for lower class students? I don't know if that seemed like a fair question. Can employment metrics be used to encourage kids to come to school, graduate?
Who would that be directed to? I'm trying to...
Either Joan or me, I think.
Pardon?
President Gable.
President Gable, okay.
Thank you, Chair Anderson. Regent Simonson, I'm not aware of any, you know, study or formal research that has noted the specific attention that college applicants pay to placement, post-graduation placement rates in selection programs. It is one of the aggregate data points, you know, schools will report it proudly, and we assume that it's attractive. And you'll hear from me tomorrow how we're doubling down on trying to measure it more robustly. There are constraints that we'll talk about in more detail tomorrow as part of the updated Maroon and Gold measures for the strategic plan. But the extent to which it's a single data point choice for an incoming freshman is assumed but not scientifically documented, as far as I know.
Regent Simonson.
Oh, thank you. It's something I think we should try to look at down the road, but thank you.
Thank you. I got time for one more question. Regent Powell, did you want to get back in line?
Well, thank you. Thank you, Chair. I'll do at this point is jump in and endorse the comments made by Regent McMillan. I do think that campus by campus thinking is really important, particularly when it comes to how we position the individual campuses from a marketing standpoint. And I think that differential tuition or strategic, you know, revenue, whatever you want to call it, is really, really important. It's really important that we recognize that price dynamics vary. So just wanted to endorse those comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Regent Powell. And I guess I was incorrect. The gentleman to my left is asking for the floor. Regent Sviggum, you're recognized for short comments from your side of the table.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I try to be to the left of very few people. And it's a
shoe fits.
It's a beautiful day in our neighborhood here, too, Mr. Chairman. Just a comment and a question, if I could. And I understand, members, the importance and the reason because of COVID-19 and its consequences why we are not requiring ACTs for this fall. But I think that there has been a general gradual and sometimes even hidden move away from ACT requirements. And that concerns me as we look at applications to our five campuses here at the University of Minnesota. I do understand that there is a holistic approach that needs to be taken. But just for example, in the holistic approach, if we could, maybe I could turn to my friend, Mr. Hoffman, my friend from up in Crookston. On page, I think it's 35, Mr. Hoffman, where you list different factors that are involved in a holistic approach. First, high school GPA. Even Mr. McMaster mentioned this in his presentation, and I certainly am aware of it. I think there's been a general inflation taking place in GPAs of high school students around the country, certainly around my area that has taken place as I talk to stakeholders such as teachers or parents. That your fourth bullet point, the high school rank in the factors, we can't even get some of the ranks anymore. There are no more rankings that become public because of other reasons. There are sometimes no more valedictorians and salutatorians that are named in high school. So, and then you get to the bottom of your factors and you talk about maybe having a couple of essays, optional essays. Very questionable sometimes are those essays in relationship to maybe who wrote them? Did a parent help? Did a friend help? Did they hire somebody to do it for them? I think a move away from a standardized test is of concern to me. And I just make that as a statement, John, that I don't want to go that direction. I do understand the need this year because of the COVID consequences. And I will leave it at that. But I just want my fellow colleagues to be aware of at least my concern and my importance placed upon some type of a standardized test in the holistic approach. And secondly, I just want to make the comment that I think our accountability to our stakeholders is so very important. And I think it was Chair Beeson. I'll call him the Chair Beeson generated maroon gold measures. Because I think, Chair Beeson, it happened under your chairmanship here at the university. And I compliment you for it. I compliment the President Keeler, who worked with you on that. We cannot and we should not move away from those generated very, very strong measures of maroon and gold. It's important to all our taxpayers, whether it's all our stakeholders, whether it's taxpayers, whether it's legislators, whether it's parents or students. I want to make sure that we keep the accountability as a university to those stakeholders. And I think the maroon and gold does do that. So thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't need
thank you, Regent Stig. I'm sorry for forgetting you there. I don't know what happened there, but I think it's been a great discussion. I think it's really, really been a good discussion. I want to thank the five campus presenters. You guys were great. I want to thank you for the passion you each have for your own campus and getting students there and retaining them and keeping them there and graduating them. So thank you for that.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
Can I make a quick, I think I said, President Brunix, I think it was President Kaler. That
and you
was.
Did say President Kaler.
I did say President Kaler? Right. Okay.
Yep. That's okay. With no further ado, that's going to bring us to our consent report. And I think our consent report, I think we're going to be asked to approve some tenure recommendations. Provost Grossen, do you want to fill us in on what's on there? What's in there?
Thank you. Thank you, Chair Anderson. Thank you, members of the board. And again, the presenters and the robust discussion. We greatly appreciate your insights. The October consent report includes requests for approval of two faculty appointments. The first request is to appoint William Dobbins, professor with tenure in the Department of Pediatrics in the Medical School. Dr. Dobbins was most recently at the University of Washington. The second request is to appoint Professor Adam Duerfelt, associate professor with tenure in the Department of Medicinal Chemistry in the College of Pharmacy. Dr. Duerfelt is joining us from the University of Oklahoma. Thank you, Chair Anderson.
Okay, thank you. Both coming from out of state, we get two more state taxpayers. That's always good. So you've heard that. I'm looking for a motion to approve the consent report.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
And it's been seconded. It's been moved and seconded, and I'm just going to pause for a moment to see if there's any region questions or comments. And I'll ask Ms. Flotten, have you seen any hands up, hands raised?
I do not.
If not, I will ask Ms. Flotten to call the roll.
On the consent report, Regent Beeson.
Aye.
Regent Beeson votes yes. Regent Davenport.
Yes.
Regent Davenport votes yes. Regent Herr is absent. Regent Hsu.
Yes.
Regent Hsu votes yes. Regent Kenyanya.
Yes.
Regent Kenyanya votes yes. Regent Mayron.
Yes.
Regent Mayron votes yes. Regent McMillan.
Yes.
Regent McMillan votes yes. Regent Powell.
Yes.
Regent Powell votes yes. Regent Rocha.
Yes.
Regent Rocha votes yes. Regent Simonson.
Yes.
Regent Simonson votes yes. Regent Swigum.
Yes.
Regent Swigum votes yes. Chair Anderson.
Yes.
Chair Anderson votes yes. Mr. Chair, there are 11 yeses and one absent.
Thank you. The consent report passes. Information items, that's our final topic. President Gable, did you want to speak on information items?
Yes, thank you, Chair Anderson. I had my notes in exactly the right place, and now here we go. Thank you, Chair Anderson. With appreciation for the exceptional efforts of our university family over the last 7 months, to navigate through the fall semester successfully in light of the current circumstances, which I'll detail in my remarks tomorrow. It is time to start thinking about the spring semester. And I think as a symbol and signal to our collective efforts and our shared governance process, we are doing that planning on time in this modified way. One of the main considerations for the spring semester that we need to consider in light of the circumstances we're in today was the timing of spring break. And that has been an extensive topic of conversation across the country and across our university community. Spring break decisions have recently been made on each of the campuses in consultation with their respective communities and governance structures, which vary. So Executive Vice President Provost Croson is here to provide more details as needed to describe the process as it exists to this point. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
I guess she's turning it over to you, Provost Croson.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair Anderson and members of the committee. Thank you, President Gable. As noted in the information report on spring break, academic leaders on each of our campuses have determined their spring breaks for the academic calendars in a way that's responsive to their local conditions, student success factors, and class scheduling needs. Each campus engaged in extensive consultation with their respective communities and governance structures. Today, I'm pleased to share an update on the status of the decisions as outlined in this report. We don't yet know what the health situation will be stemming from the pandemic for this spring, yet we need to make a decision now about the spring calendar in order for class schedules to be determined in advance of course registrations, which open shortly. Across all campuses, we will be continuing the 6 feet physical distancing and instructor choice of modality that we adopted for this fall. And for all campuses, we are maintaining our spring semester start and end dates, which is important for financial aid processing. On Monday of this week, a concurrent meeting of the University Senate and Faculty Senate held a final discussion and a Faculty Senate vote on the motions for changes to the spring break on the Twin Cities, Rochester, and Morris campuses. Pursuant to the policy on academic calendars, the Senate Committee on Educational Policy recommended an exception to the calendar originally adopted for spring 21 to accommodate these changes. For the Twin Cities and Rochester campuses, the Faculty Senate overwhelmingly approved moving the spring break for undergraduate and graduate colleges to the week of April 5th. Professional schools retain control over their own calendars. This decision will preserve a 5-day contiguous break, which was strongly preferred by our students and many faculty and staff. It will also enable us to watch how the public health situation develops and to consider what mode of instruction would be best for the weeks after spring break and for final exams. We'll make that decision well in advance, but in a way that is responsive to the fast-moving pandemic landscape. For the Morris campus, the Faculty Senate also overwhelmingly approved the revised Morris calendar, which you can find in your docket. Morris will shift spring break from a single week to individual break days dispersed across the semester. Crookston and Duluth have their own calendar governance process. For the Crookston campus, the spring break week will be replaced with a midweek study day and two added study days at the end of the term between the last day of classes and finals week. For the Duluth campus, the spring break will include 2 days off, a Monday and a Tuesday, with instruction occurring on the remaining 3 days. 3 new study days will then occur between the end of instruction and exam week. Duluth's recommendation was affirmed by their Faculty Senate and Student Association. The chancellors and I have overseen a rigorous consultation process enlisting a broad range of students, faculty, staff, and academic administrators in order to determine how best to advance our academic missions and minimize the damage attributable to COVID-19. A second report, along with this month's information items, is the regular description of select student, faculty, and staff accomplishments, which is a reminder for us to pause and reflect on the ongoing work and accomplishments among and across the university. Some highlights from this month. The NSF has awarded the University Materials Research Science and Engineering Center $18 million in renewed funding over the next 6 years. The program is among only 11 centers nationwide receiving this funding for successful collaborative research. The center's materials research enables development ranging from biomedicine and electronics to security and renewable energy. CEHD's Institute on Community Integration has received a grant from the U.S. Centers of Disease Control and Prevention. Investigators will explore MinLink data sets for autism spectrum disorder indicators to improve the delivery of service and diagnose symptoms at an early age. Roundtable RX, a newly launched University of Minnesota startup, will donate unused medications to Minnesotans who cannot afford their prescriptions. Finally, some of you will have seen the news releases, and Vice President Kramer mentioned the 2 MacArthur Fellowships received by our faculty, sometimes referred to as genius grants. Cognitive neuroscientist Damien Fair from the College of Education and Human Development and director of the Masonic Institute for the Developing Brain, and chemical engineering professor Paul J. Power from the College of Science and Engineering. And we congratulate both of those faculty. I'm happy to take any questions anyone might have on these informational agendas. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, I was about ready to adjourn, but I see that Regent Powell wanted to say something. Is that true?
No, sorry, Chair Anderson. No, I do not have my hand raised.
Okay, well, I got bad information. So thanks for a great meeting, everybody. Before we adjourn, I just want to tell you that we're going to reconvene in 15 minutes. That would be about 10:50. Thank you. Meeting adjourned.
Well, I think you said exactly what Powell was going to say. So.